Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. We had our guest speaker, Professor Christopher Veniamin, give his first session last evening. And prior to that, I gave quite a long description of who he is and such, and I'm not going to give that long one again this morning. First of all, I'd like to welcome you to St. Paul Antiochian Orthodox Church. I'm Father James Bernstein, and this is a WOCA-sponsored event, standing for Washington Orthodox Clergy Association, the Free Lenten Retreat. And so we welcome all of you. I see that we have a number of parishioners from the various Orthodox churches in this area. And we welcome you here to this event and to St. Paul Orthodox Church. So just a very brief introduction. To be reminded, for those of you who were not here yesterday, that professor is a professor of Patristic Theology at St. Tikhon Seminary for over 20 years. And he is a spiritual child of Elder Sophrony of Essex, Great Britain. And he knew St. Porphyrios and Elder, and now newly canonized St. Paisios, and also Elder Emilianos. So I like to say, you know, he knew, had associations with, is a friend of saints. And so this is one of the great advantages of having him come to speak with us, because here in America, well, unfortunately, we don't have many saints. And, So he has that association. And so, you know, when we hear him speak, it's not just intellectual, it's heartfelt and deeply spiritual, which comes from that tradition. So he is also close to Metropolitan Hierotheos Vlachos, and I know many of us have read books written by Metropolitan Hierotheos Vlachos. And his three-part lecture is going to be on, well, last evening was a metanoia, which is repentance. And today, two lectures will be on Hezekiah, which is stillness, and the third one on theosis, which is deification, transfigurement. Now, we do have a number of books that are published by Mount Tabor Publishing, which is his publishing company, and including the book from which the lectures are taken from, which is The Orthodox Understanding of Salvation by Professor Christopher Veniamin. And we have quite a few here, so if you would like to be able to get an expanded version of what he is teaching and be able to read it at home, this is the book to get. And then in addition, there are other books that he'll make mention of before his presentation. Okay, so, Professor.
God bless you, teacher. Well, first of all, I must thank God for bringing me here to be among you. And really for blessing me to be enriched by coming into contact with so many precious souls, brothers and sisters, precious brothers and sisters in Christ. For how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. I'm extremely humbled by the words of Father James's gracious introduction, as also by those of Father Nicholas Keim, because as you will soon realize, compared to the great figures that I will be referring to and quoting, I myself am like a little dog. But by the grace of God, for reasons which only He knows, it seems that it's part of my service to the church to pass on the crumbs that I have received from these giants to those of you who are interested. Because as you know, there is a broken world which we as Christians have been called to be the salt of. And that's a high calling, it's a great responsibility. Who can do that? Only God. But we do our best, as imperfect as we are, and we beseech God to work His miracle of transforming people's hearts, which He can do and which He does. I'm blessed to see among you Father Seraphim, a former student of mine. He suffered considerably at my hands. But he's come out of that all right. Thank God. Father Nicholas mentioned the many and unseen ways by which people have contributed to this event and many other things besides. And we owe them a debt of gratitude. We thank them for all that they've done for making this event possible and for the many other things that they are doing for the church in service to our Lord God and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's truly humbling for me to be here. And as St. Gregory Palamas keeps saying, and I feel that it certainly applies to me for reasons which only the Lord knows, I've been blessed to know you wonderful people. So I will try my best today to talk to you on a subject that may seem at first a little strange. The subject is about Hezekiah, Ezechiah, stillness or quietude. The title of this section, actually, in my book, The Orthodox Understanding of Salvation, is on becoming theologians. Because I believe that in Father Sophrony, I was blessed to encounter a true theologian. And I will do my best to convey some of it to you. I beg for your charity as you listen to my poor words and ask for your prayers and your indulgence. So, on becoming theologians, as Father Sophrony of Essex writes, the Gospel teaches us that for a whole week before his glorious transfiguration, our Lord God and Savior, Jesus Christ, performed no miracle and spoke no word. In short, in all three synoptic narratives, there is a significant period of silence before the Taborian theophany takes place. Indeed, the Gospel of Luke specifies that it was while the Lord was praying that his wondrous change occurred. Prayer, silence, and stillness, what the fathers refer to as Hezekiah, preceded this great biblical event, the manifestation of Christ's pre-eternal divinity in and through his assumed human flesh, and therefore also the revelation of God's purpose in his creation of man. As Christ, the divine hypostasis of the Logos is beheld by the three chosen disciples, resplendent even in the flesh, in the light of his divine glory. As true and perfect God and true and perfect man, the uniquely incarnate person of the Son and Word of God is for us the measure of all things, both divine and human. He is the way. No man cometh to the Father but by me. And again, as the Lord himself says, I have given you an example. And the example that we see here in the transfiguration of the Savior on Mount Tabor is that prayer and stillness, isichia, precede the clear vision of God. Now, this simple fact is, of course, attested to not only by the Transfiguration, but throughout Holy Scripture. Beginning with Genesis, we read of the Holy Spirit hovering in silence upon the waters before creation bursts forth. Following the 6 days of creation, God rests on the Sabbath, on the seventh day, which is also a foreshowing of the Lord's three-day burial. We notice the silence in Jacob's spiritual struggle as he wrestled with God all night long before meeting with his brother Esau, who wanted to kill him. After which, Jacob exclaims, I have seen God face to face, and my soul is saved. In Exodus, we find Moses and the people of Israel keeping silence before Moses entered the cloud to be with God. Similarly, Joshua and the Israelites kept silence for 7 days after they camped outside Jericho, before the trumpets sounded and the walls came tumbling down, which was a clear sign that the Lord was working with them. And Job's seven-day silence before opening his mouth to speak with power. That is to say, to speak inspired by God. And let us not forget Elijah's silence on Horeb and the fact that God was afterwards revealed to him in the still small voice. And of course, the greatest Hesychast of all, the Mother of God and ever Virgin, who practiced silence in the temple and through the period before she received the glad tidings of the Annunciation from Gabriel. And we find the Lord manifesting his power after stillness and silence on the Mount of Olives and in the desert. And the resurrection itself takes place after all flesh had been stilled for 3 days, as we are taught by the beautiful hymn, "Let all mortal flesh be still," sung in place of the cherubic hymn on Holy Saturday. And the Holy Spirit came down upon the disciples at Pentecost, while they too kept silence with one accord in prayer. And to all these wonderful events, we may add what the great God-bearer Ignatius of Antioch tells us about the Word of God himself being born pre-eternally of the silence of the Father. What the Transfiguration and all these great events in the history of our salvation show us is that if we truly desire to meet God and have a face-to-face vision of him, we need first to prepare ourselves for that encounter through prayer and stillness, through Hezekiah. As the psalmist says, "Be still and know that I am God." For unless we know the Lord, we cannot be true theologians. And more importantly, we cannot give a word of comfort to those whom we have been called to minister, unless we ourselves have been comforted by the Comforter. So prayer and silence must precede our encounter with God. Theology is the description of our encounter with God. And this encounter is also the prerequisite for our ministry to others as his servants. Most significantly, the liturgical cycle of the Orthodox Church gives us ample opportunity to be still and focus on the one thing needful. Sunday, the weekly celebration of the Lord's resurrection, and all the major feasts of the ecclesiastical year prescribe argia for us, that is to say, resting from all of our usual work, not simply in order to cease working physically and mentally, but rather to help us to learn to focus on things eternal instead of things temporal. It is an important reminder, especially for us in our workaholic and stressed out society, that all the things that the world considers important, money, power, and fame, will in fact one day come to an end, and that inevitably each and every one of us will be faced with the question of eternity. But having said all this, how do we attain to the kind of prayer and stillness that we find in the example given by the Lord and his saints? Where is this kind of prayer and standing before God to be found? The answer to this question is that it is to be found in the heart, the spiritual center of man's being, which coincides with, but is not limited to, the physical heart. And the way it is to be found is by following the example of Christ, which is the mystery of his descent from on high, and his cross, which reaches down into the nethermost parts of Hades. Turning once again, therefore, to the example that the Lord gives us in his person, we find him in the Garden of Gethsemane, sweating great drops of blood, engaged in a prayer dialogue with God the Father, as he is about to go forth to endure the passion of the cross for our sakes. Now, firstly, as the Son and Word of God, consubstantial with the Father, and equal in every respect with him in his divine status, Christ's human will, as St. John Damascene tells us, always willed what the divine will willed it to will. Therefore, there was never any possibility of Christ not following the will of the Father or diverging from it. For the divine will of the Father is also his very own divine will, for it is one and the same. And Christ's human will was, from the very moment of his conception in his mother's womb, in perfect harmony with his divine will. And what is true of Christ, by virtue of the hypostatic union and the communicatio idiomatum that follows it, also becomes a reality in us by grace. Therefore, those who strive to follow his example and his way receive the privilege of existing on the plane of his divine will and life. Christ is our example of obedience, and his way is the pattern of our life. Secondly, Christ did not need to pray. As the divine Logos, he was and is always in full and perfect communion with God the Father, once again, by virtue of the homoousion, by virtue of his consubstantiality. But he does pray in his human nature in order to give us the example that we human persons ought to follow. And this is emphasized by his agony, in which he sheds drops of blood as he faces the prospect of death. Therefore, we too, following the example of Christ and his saints, whenever we find ourselves threatened by pain, suffering, or death, learn to take the opportunity to enter into a prayer dialogue with God. For thereby, we transform anything that may befall us into a spiritual state. Thirdly, death for Christ was by no means inevitable. On the contrary, as the very source and author of life, death was totally foreign and unnatural to him. Therefore, he did not need to die. There's a wonderful homily by St. Gregory Palamas. It's number 16 in this edition. And it's also, this is the complete edition of St. Gregory Palamas with detailed notes and introduction. But it's also contained in the book, The Saving Work of Christ, which is part of a series where I've taken selections of St. Gregory's homilies in order to make them more easily digestible, as it were, by people who might be a little intimidated by an 800-page hardbound copy of a book which contains a lot of Greek and other languages as well. But in homily 16, in fact, the subtitle of homily 16, which is a homily given on Holy Saturday on redemption, the subtitle reads, "Also teaching that God was able to redeem man from the devil's tyranny in many different ways, but rightly preferred this dispensation." And as we were saying last night, speaking with a few of you, St. Gregory says, rightly preferred this dispensation because the way that God willed to save us was the most perfect manifestation of his humility and his self-sacrificial love for us. So, yes, he did not need to die. We cannot say that God was obliged to do anything. God is totally and absolutely free. So what we observe here is the reality of the hypostatic union of our nature in the single and unique person hypostasis of the Son and Word of God, and all the things that follow naturally from it. The mystery of his two natural energies and two natural wills. We find Christ in Gethsemane actually fearing death, or more correctly, shrinking from death. For as St. John of the Ladder explains, this is the mystery of the Lord, fearing death, but not being terrified by it. In other words, as the author of life, it was unnatural for the divine Logos incarnate to suffer death. For his human nature is the flesh of none other than the Son and Word of God, who was in the beginning and by whom all things were made. Christ's death, then, was innocent and totally voluntary. But he accepts the shame of death on the cross in order to reveal his boundless self-sacrificial love and the humble way of divine life. Greater love hath no man, that he describes so vividly in his Sermon on the Mount, which we too must strive to follow if we wish to be with him. For unless we become like him, we cannot be with him. But by the Lord's death on the cross, the power of death was completely vanquished, and joy came into the world, the joy of the resurrection by Christ's triumph over death. And this is precisely what those who are willing to follow the way of Christ experience in their own self-denial, as they take up their cross and follow his way. Joy, lasting joy that cannot be taken away from us. Here we have the paradox that the Lord speaks of when he says, he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. Gethsemane, therefore, understood theologically and not psychologically, is a remarkable confirmation of the reality of the Lord's incarnation, of God's truly becoming man for our sakes, and of giving us the authentic pattern of the Christian way of life. Now, this example is of vital importance to us because it teaches us that whatever difficulty, suffering, or misfortune may befall us, we too ought to use the pain that is experienced owing to the threat of death to open up a prayer dialogue with God and enter into communion with the physician of our souls and bodies. For by so doing, we are accepting the pain as from the hand of God, and thereby remarkably discovering our heart. And from the depths of our heart, we are then able to speak, to truly speak to God, thereby transforming whatever may befall us, psychological, emotional, or even physical, into a spiritual state. Father Zacharias talks about this at some length in his books, especially the Enlargement of the Heart, The Hidden Man of the Heart. And even in Remember Thy First Love. In his encomium for the martyr Gordius, St. Basil the Great exhorts us to make voluntary that which is involuntary, and not to spare life whose privation is unavoidable. He's saying, we're going to die sooner or later, so make sure that when that comes to you, you do it voluntarily. However it comes, make sure that you do it voluntarily, because we're going to lose our lives anyway. So let's lose our lives in imitation of Christ's voluntary death. And St. Gregory Palamas, writing about 1,000 years later, actually, St. John Chrysostom teaches us that it is not death, but death in sin that is evil. St. Gregory Palamas, about 1,000 years later, says, he urges his people to resist sin even unto death, if need be, and makes what seems to be a bold statement indeed when he says, except for sin, nothing in this life, even death itself, is really evil, even if it causes suffering. The company of the saints brought bodily sufferings upon themselves. The martyrs made the violent death which others inflicted on them into something magnificent, a source of life, glory, and the eternal heavenly kingdom, because they exploited it in a good way that pleased God. As the saints show, following the example of Christ himself, it is our spiritual disposition that really matters. The desire to learn the humble way of Christ. And so the mystery is that the more we embrace and follow his way, the more we enter into the stream of his own life, and the more we receive his grace to live his commandments and become increasingly like him, which, as the Transfiguration shows us, is the very purpose of our existence, to become by grace all that he is by nature. Now, in case this sounds rather theoretical, let us attempt to summarize this last point in simpler language. Archimandrite Sophrony used to say that we must learn to live by inspiration. In practical terms, this simply means that, aided by the life in the church, we must acquire the habit of turning to God at all times and in all things, so that before we act, before we speak, before we even think anything, we turn our hearts and minds to Christ, our true God. And in that way, as the great Paul says, all things may be sanctified by the word of God and by prayer, which is in fact the shape of the divine liturgy. For the anaphora of the divine liturgy, in the anaphora of the divine liturgy, we are taught to refer our whole life and one another unto Christ our God, acknowledging him as the giver of all good things in thanksgiving, following his example and thereby reversing the sin of our forefather Adam. And so, if we truly wish to become theologians in the tradition of our fathers, If we truly wish to have a face-to-face encounter with God Himself in the tradition of the saints, then we must learn the ethos and spirit of the divine liturgy, which contains everything. To quote Saint Irenaeus of Lyon, a spiritual grandchild of the apostles, "Our way of thinking is in harmony with the Eucharist, and the Eucharist confirms our thinking." Thank you. So we have reached the end of the first section, first part of this session. I hope that I have prompted you to think a little deeply on the question of prayer and stillness, ησυχία, and how the Bible and the tradition of the Church teaches us, in fact shows us quite clearly, that ησυχία is a prerequisite for the encounter with God. In other words, we're all very busy, we're doing many, many things, and many of those things are good things, but it's important for us to remember that it's of paramount importance to have some alone time with God. And once again, I hope I haven't raised more questions than I've answered in my presentation. Please feel free to comment or ask questions, and I'll do my best to answer. Father Nicholas.
Anyway, he gave a series of talks, and there is a book, I think it's either Hesychia and Theology, or I think it was that book, maybe you'll remember, but there's a statement in there by one of the nuns who said, there's a strong anti-hesychastic wind blowing in the west. Do you remember that statement?
Yeah, I think so. I think so.
I think it was one of the nuns from the monastery who published this book. Anyway, so I asked him, what do you think causes that? And he said, our secular way of life. Our extremely secular way of life. I'm sure there are other reasons, but I just wondered if you could comment on that a little bit further in light of traditional Orthodox cultures and heterodox, pretty secular cultures that we live in. One kind of fosters that, or opens the door, recognizes, supports that hesychastic way of life. Maybe doesn't even, but it snuffs it out, and smothers it.
Yes. So Father Nicholas is asking about how the hesychastic way of life is encouraged or discouraged in our society, discouraged in the West, as it were, encouraged more in Orthodox countries, in Orthodox cultures. Yes, it's true. In the West, we have a challenge that perhaps is not there, at least to the same degree, in Orthodox cultures. This is the blessing of having an Orthodox history, an Orthodox tradition in one's part of the world. Because as we said last night, we live in a culture which doesn't understand repentance. We live in a culture which doesn't really know how to repent. And when we wish to repent, in other words, when we wish to approach Christ and change in order to enter into the stream of becoming like Christ, the tradition of becoming like Christ, we don't have the understanding around us anywhere, almost anywhere anyway. We have a psychological approach to life. So it's very countercultural. If you begin to feel the sense of your unworthiness and you turn to God and ask for healing, be people around you who would say, come on, you're okay, you know. Yeah, don't be so hard on yourself, you know. And it's difficult because repentance in the wrong context can lead to illness, can lead to maladies. Thank God the church is everywhere. And I think that's why I tried to emphasize last night the importance of having a correct spiritual disposition, a humble disposition, learning by reference to the Holy Scriptures, by reference to the divine liturgy, calling upon the name of the Lord. We acquire a certain ethos and we acquire a certain sense of balance and measure. But it is nevertheless true that it's helpful when there are more people around you, some of whom at least understands what it means to repent, and that it's a positive thing, and that it's a wonderful transformation that we must all undergo, because unless we change, we cannot become like Christ. And the history of the church has always been this how shall I put it? There has been times in the history of the church itself where hesychasm, in other words, what is hesychasm? It's the tradition of prayer, the spiritual life of the church, emphasizing the inner life of the church, without which the things that we do lose their content, lose their meaning. It's important to be engaged in the spiritual life of the church, because that is what initiates us into the mystery of the fullness of the stature of Christ. It's what unites us with Christ and helps us to enter into communion with Christ, and we are freed from the moralism, etc., of the world, the moralisms and the legalisms and all the other stuff that we're tempted to think of and to live according to. So what I'm trying to say is that there's always been a tension in the life of the church. Hesychasm, the life of prayer, has sometimes emerged very strongly, sometimes been seemingly the experience of relatively few. But it's there, abundantly attested to in the Holy Scriptures and in sacred tradition as the way of communion with God. In fact, Saint Gregory the Sinaite gives a wonderful series of definitions of prayer, what prayer is, and ultimately he says, well, prayer is God himself working all things in all human beings. So we're talking about communion with God, how to enter into that communion. Another way of describing that is what we said last night, how to attract the grace of God, learning how to preserve the grace of God. This is the challenge of the spiritual life, and it is revealed to us in the commandments of Christ, chiefly in his commandments of love and in his very example by which he saved us. So, yes, I mean, the whole Orthodox ethos is, you know, we're going against the grain, we're swimming against the tide. We know that, but the world has always been at enmity with God. That's the way of the world. The enemy is doing his job, and we must try to focus, keep our focus on Christ and do ours in order to bring healing, to help to bring healing to this broken world. In order, in other words, to bear witness in our own lives to that love of Christ. And there's no more powerful force in the end. Love, the love of God, conquers all. And that is what we learn in the life of the church. And we must try to be connected to that which inspires us. That's why I mentioned the Holy Scriptures, the Divine Liturgy, calling upon the name of the Lord, and many other things, the lives of the saints. And the reassurance that the saints are with us, because God gives us saints in every age and in every generation, and proves to us that the life in Christ, perfection in Christ, to which we have been called, is possible for each and every one of us. To be raised to the level of divine life, this is an astounding, majestic vision of the purpose of our existence. And we said also last night that this willingness to follow Christ to the end, which we see in the saints, stems from gratitude. It doesn't stem from some morbid desire to beat themselves up. That's not asceticism. Father Sophrony used to say, asceticism is spiritual labors, and spiritual labors are living the commandments of Christ. So we have all been called to be ascetics. We've not all been called to be monks. Don't get me wrong. This is not an exhortation for us to... it depends on what God's will is for you. Saint Simeon, the new theologian, says, you must discover what it is for you, what God's will is for you personally. And that is the best. He said, I refuse to say what's a higher state and what's a lower state. You could argue in the abstract that the highest state must be the state that Christ lived. He was not married. But that's not what Christ asks of us, and it's not what St. Paul asks of us. It's not what the church asks of us. What the church asks of us is for us to discover the will of God for us. And that is the best thing for each one of us. So, yes, it's very important for us to have a balanced and a measured understanding of the spiritual life. I remember, well, you know, people ask, what was it like to be with Father Sophrony? And what did he say? And what did he do? And of course, there are many things that one could answer to those questions, but I think that the two things that stand out for me, perhaps three, is that, as Father Zacharias says, there was always an abundance of the Word of God in Father Sophrony's presence. When you asked him anything, he would give you a word that was loaded, charged with divine grace, and had the power to draw you into his spiritual world, which was a blessing that, as I said last night, also contains the mystery of the cross. Because after that experience, you go back to your spiritual world. Now, in that word, there was an abundance of discernment. And I see how important discernment is, even according to my limited understanding. It's such a precious and valuable thing. A saying attributed to Saint Anthony the Great is that when they asked him, what's the greatest gift of the Holy Spirit? He said, the discernment of the spirits. Discernment. To have a balanced and measured way of life. Don't forget, the Christian way of life is the normal way of life. This is what we were created for. The other stuff is abnormal. And so it behoves us to seek to discover the will of God. And actually, there's a wonderful, wonderful section in St. Silwan the Athenite, the book by Father Sophrony. It's hidden in a chapter called The Staritz's Doctrinal Teaching. And it starts off with discovering the will of God and on obedience. And there, Father Sophrony lays out a distillation of patristic wisdom on the question of, all right, so how do we discover the will of God? Now, one of the things that he used to teach us, I mentioned in my paper that he would encourage us to live by inspiration. In other words, if somebody asks you a question, you ask me a question, I could answer that question based on what I know, my training, my confident in my own abilities. I could say, oh, I know the answer to Father's question. Here it is. But Father Sophrony said, no, don't do that. When you're confronted with any situation, before you act, before you speak, even before you think anything, turn your heart and your mind first to God. Ask for enlightenment. Ask for a blessing. That can be done, you know, even wordlessly, because it's an inclination of the heart. It's an impulse of the heart. And he would encourage us to acquire that habit and to see from our own personal experience what the results are. You know, you shall know them by their fruits. Try it and see. And you see, remarkably, that the results are better than they otherwise would be. You see that you're given something to say, for example, that sometimes you say, well, I didn't even know that. I didn't even know that I could answer that or deal with that situation. How to get around it, or how to, you know, negotiate a certain situation or circumstance. And when we learn to do that, you know, that's a way of this habitual turning towards God, this habitual impulse to refer to God first. That's the shape of the liturgy. That's the anaphora. First, before we take a glass of water, we turn our mind to God. Why? In thanks. To thank Him. He is the giver. And we must learn that every moment of our life is on loan. Our very existence is from Him, that we continue to exist is because of His will. We were created out of nothing. And if it were not His will to sustain us in existence, we would pass again into nothing, into nothingness. So we learn to do this, and it's a form of calling upon the name of the Lord. Because God wants us 100%. And when we are 100% His, then He will give us everything that is His and hold nothing back, because it's His goodwill to fill us with His life, His glory, His love, and then we truly say how good and pleasant it is to dwell together as brethren in unity, which, you know, the Church teaches us is an image of heaven. Heaven is the Holy Spirit. The kingdom of heaven is within us, and we have been called to become temples of the Holy Spirit. It's a high calling. And Father Sophrony used to say one other thing. He said, if you water down the life of repentance, and you think, you're tempted to think, oh, you know, well, that's okay for those people, or people in monasteries, or not for everyone, you know. It's not for everyone. Just go to church, read your Bible, you know, you'll be okay. If you water that down, Father Sophrony says, what you are doing, in fact, is shutting the gates to the way to perfection in Christ, shutting the doors of repentance. When, you know, the Church in this period, we sing, open the gates of repentance unto us, O giver of life. So, yes, I touched upon a number of themes there. But you see how Orthodox theology, the spiritual life, are inextricably intertwined, and really we're speaking of one thing. And that one thing is about the fact that we have been created in the image of God in order to become like Him. That is, that has been revealed to us, among other things, in the Holy Transfiguration, where we see, as I said, God's purpose in His creation of man. This is inspiring. This is, the majestic vision of our calling. This can inspire, this can truly encourage, comfort, to know that our God is the God of love, who wants to save each and every one of us, no matter where He finds us, and that the good news of the gospel is that God loves you personally to the degree that His love is to the very end. Father Sophrony's, it was always hard to describe in words without making it sound sentimental. He was fully present before God. He was fully focused on God. When he celebrated the liturgy, every ounce of his being, every fiber of his being was turned towards God. And I'm always reminded of a term that is used in reference to St. Basil the Great. That term is uranophandor in Greek. It means revealer of the heavens. St. Basil the Great, such was his sanctity. We know that he gave us the greatest of all the divine liturgies. He is the revealer of the heavens, and that's how I felt standing in the altar, serving in the altar with Father Sophrony there, praying. And as I said, it may sound simplistic, but what the saints do for us is they make concrete in their person and their example the love of Christ. We see the image of Christ more clearly thanks to their union and their communion with Christ and the way that they treat us with great leniency, with great love, and so on. It's a high culture. And yes, we live in a culture that knows very little about repentance, so easily misunderstood and misrepresented. We live in a culture which tends to go to extremes because it lacks those checks and balances that are present in an Orthodox culture. An Orthodox culture, I mean, let's take what's commonly referred to as Byzantium, you know, the Christian Roman Empire. There were passions and sins and all kinds of evil things in the Christian Roman Empire. But they had something that we still have to acquire, and that is the ethos of repentance. I could say, we could sum it up as the ethos of repentance, as a very powerful force, powerful and positive force for change, where we live for the other. What does Christ teach us? To live for the other, to make room for the other, to put the other first. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one for the other. The love that Christ revealed. Greater love hath no man. So, yes.
I'm a musician, as are you. I'm a songwriter and composer. I'm sure everybody in this room loves music, whether it be liturgical music, paraliturgical, or secular music of all kinds. I like to say that silence is the canvas upon which I paint my music. So I'm curious what you have to say about hesychism and stillness in relationship to music, whether it be sacred or secular.
Yes, thank you. Well, I wouldn't describe myself as a musician. In fact, God has very skillfully taken that away from me, because he's placed me in a non-Byzantine seminary, a tradition with a non-Byzantine, whereas I used to sing professionally in Greece for a very short time, but nevertheless I was trained and I began doing that. And then I was placed by God somewhere where I was encouraged to pray a little more and exercise a bit more silence. Yeah, it's a good question. The relationship between music, for example, and the way of stillness is here. You know, the truth is that we are beset by so many thoughts, and the fathers teach us that we must learn the way of stillness, in the sense that, you know, everything ultimately boils down to one thought. Everything boils down to one thought. And I know that there are traditions which will encourage you to erase all thoughts from your mind, because thoughts are recognized as being the cause of suffering. Thinking is the cause of suffering, and therefore we have traditions that encourage us to free ourselves of all thoughts, of all thinking. In short, all I want to say in response to your question is that Christians have been called to cultivate one thought, and that thought is Jesus Christ. And so it really doesn't matter what you do in your life, whether you are a musician or whether you're doing something completely different. What we all have in common is that we are I would use the word tempted to allow many and various thoughts into our spiritual world. Now, some of those thoughts, as the fathers teach us, some of them come from the enemy, some of them come from the man's own spiritual world, and some of them are from God, and we must develop the discernment, a kind of radar in our heart to distinguish the thoughts, to be able, as I mentioned, Saint Anthony said, the discernment of spirits. But as I say, ultimately, the object of the exercise is to fill ourselves with Christ. And one thought, what is that one thought? Jesus. God saves, Yahweh saves. The Savior. It was always a bit of a conundrum to me in my early student years, because I used to hear from my professors how St. Gregory Palamas and the other hesychasts of the 13th and 14th century would refer to the publican's prayer as the Jesus prayer. And I, you know, looking at the prayer of the publican, God be merciful unto me, a sinner. I was expecting, you know, but how could that be the Jesus prayer? The name Jesus is not pronounced. God be merciful unto me, a sinner. But I learned subsequently that the reason why that is the Jesus prayer, is the same thing as the Jesus prayer, is because it's asking for salvation. It's asking for God's help. It's asking God to heal. It's asking God to work his miracle of transformation in our deep heart. And so, yes, that is the object of the exercise, for us to fill our being with Christ. And as we said, the most perfect image of Christ is there, written in the Holy Scriptures, especially the Gospels, which is why we have the Gospel on the holy altar. The priest carries the Gospel around in procession. That's the image of Christ. The bishop is also the living image of Christ, and by extension, the priest also. In other words, there are many things in the liturgical life of the church that will encourage us to focus on Christ, to remember Christ, to see that he is the Savior, to remind us of all the great things that God has done for us. So we have the Holy Scriptures, we have the Divine Liturgy, we have the tradition of calling upon the name of the Lord, because in calling upon the name of the Lord, we experience the grace that is directly from, it's the energy that is from the person named. And this simple Sophrony would say, learn to turn your heart and your mind to God in all things, in every circumstance. You know, we try that, and we see, we experience some success, and we say, oh, we'll try to do that more. And when we forget, we say, ah, I didn't do that, and that could have been better. And we see the results, and we see the results when we do that, and we see the results when we don't do that. And we learn by trial and error what helps and what doesn't help. And we see that that helps a lot. And we continue to do that. And we learn to acquire that as a habit, as a second, as an instinct, as second nature, as it were. But it is important to also know that the Jesus prayer, calling upon the name of the Lord, is also referred to as the prayer of a single thought, imonologistos ευχή, the prayer of a single thought. Because Christ is everything. Christ is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the first and the last. And there is no revelation of God outside Christ. Christ is the sole revealer of God the Father. He is the express image of his person. And we cannot know the divinity of Christ unless it is revealed to us by the Holy Spirit. In the Holy Spirit, we are guided to all the truth. But all the truth is not a thing. All the truth is not a concept. The truth is a person. And that person is Jesus Christ. And that is what was revealed on the day of Pentecost to the apostles. And that is what is revealed to every saint who experiences the vision of Christ in glory, the whole Christ. That's why we don't have in the Orthodox tradition a progressive understanding of revelation. All the truth is given because the truth is not a concept. Theology is not a series of concepts transmitted from the mind of God into the minds of human beings. Theology is the vision of Christ in glory. Theology is the vision of the risen Christ. And he is the truth. And the revelation of Jesus Christ is the revelation of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Because we're speaking of one God, one being, who is triune. And Father Sophrony describes the purpose of human existence in his way by referring to the hypostatic principle in us. Once, in other words, we resemble the hypostasis of the second person of the Holy Trinity in whose image we were created. At that point, we have been called to achieve, and at that point we achieve the universality of Christ. That Christ embraces all in his person. His love, as was revealed to us when he descended from on high down to the nethermost parts of the earth, in other words, down into Hades, to reveal to us that his love and his life embraces all of creation. And there's no place that has not been filled with the light of his divine glory and his love. And all things are resurrected in and through him. So, the saints reveal to us the majesty of the grandeur of our calling, of God's vision of man, why he created us and brought us into this life. And we thank him. We thank him so many times. We thank him in the divine liturgy for bringing us into existence out of nothing. Because he is I am. He is the one who is. And in him, Father Sophrony says, we can say by grace, I am. And death is overcome. And all things are filled with the light of his love and his glory. Sometimes we have, and forgive me, fathers, I'm not suggesting that you should change this, particularly without the blessing of your bishops, but sometimes we say in Vespers and other parts of the services, Christ the existing, right? We say Christ the existing. It's Christ He who is Oon Evlogitos, the one who was revealed to Moses when Moses first received the clearest revelation that God is personal, that the highest existence in this universe is person, something which the human mind could never conceive of. I am he who is. Very important. The greatest revelation in the Old Testament dispensation. Yes?
I really would love it if you could speak something, tell us about the process the church goes through in designating a saint, and particularly in the case of Father Sophrony, how that is working.
Yes. How is a saint proclaimed as such in the tradition of the Orthodox Church? Well, I'm sure you are already probably aware that the way that this happens is basically that it begins from the level of the people who knew a certain person, knew his life, especially his manner of life and his teaching, or her life and her teaching, and who are convinced that that person was indeed an example of the love of Christ. So in short, it begins at the grassroots level. It's not the product of some church committee coming down from above and deciding that it's time to make so-and-so a saint or proclaim so-and-so a saint. It comes from the life of the church. It really is the life of the church. Saint Simeon the New Theologian, about 1,000 years ago, had no doubt as to the sanctity of his own spiritual father, Simeon the Devout, who himself was a simple monk. And Simeon got himself into some trouble because he was accused of having icons and writing services and such to his spiritual father, and encouraging a cult of his spiritual father. In actual fact, that was used as an excuse against him by others to condemn him of disobeying the hierarchy of the church. The real reason was something else. But in the example of Saint Simeon, we see how these things begin very clearly. The people who have lived with a certain person benefited greatly. But I will say that the monastery of Saint John, disciples of Father Sophrony, are, as it were. When I asked Father Kirill last June, what is the situation as far as the canonization of Elder Sophrony, he said, until we receive a letter from the Patriarchate, we don't say anything. And they have a very interesting, and I think a very prudent approach, because they don't encourage anyone to say Saint Sophrony. They don't say Saint Sophrony. they don't do that at all. Out of deference to the church, out of respect to the church, waiting for the seal of the church. It's not that they don't know the caliber of Father Sophrony. But I think that it's very telling. It's a good lesson, the approach that they have. There's no hurry. There's no anxiety. They don't treat it as something which would shed some glory upon them. Father Sophrony, I'll tell you a story about Father Sophrony. My experience of Father Sophrony. Whenever I approached Father Sophrony with the thought, sometimes I would have the thought, he's a holy man, he's a saint, get his blessing. As I would lean over to receive his blessing, he would punch me like that. I don't know how he knew what I was thinking, but he would punch me, not a knuckle sandwich, but with this part of his hand, he would punch me like that. And then I would be, shocked, not knowing and being in a panic, not knowing what to do. I would try to kiss his hand again, and it would punch me again. He didn't like to be regarded as anything. He discouraged that. The only thing he wanted was that his the spiritual children would follow Christ. He was not interested in the least in the glory of men. He did not care for the opinion, although he didn't deliberately try to scandalize anyone. He was very respectful and polite and, loving. But he never wanted you to approach him in that way. You see, Father Sophrony had really immersed himself in Oriental religious meditations and techniques when he was still a young artist in Paris. He was quite successful. And he engaged it. He was seduced by what he refers to in his book, His Life is Mine. He was seduced by the concept of the suprapersonal absolute. That the absolute highest form of existence must be suprapersonal, above and beyond the person. The person, in philosophy and in certain Oriental religious traditions is puny, weak. How can you even think that the supreme deity would in any way be personal? Anyway, so he was aware of the Oriental religious traditions. 8 years he spent really immersed in those practices, and he came away by the grace of God when it was revealed to him what the significance of Moses' revelation on Sinai was, that God is personal, I am, that the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob is the supreme being, the supreme form, the highest form of existence, and so on. So he never wanted us to treat him like a guru or like a, as I said, anything special. Very, very far from it. In fact, once upon a time, I was very embarrassed. If people ask, what did he say, what did he do? It was just one look that he gave me. We were working outside his house. There's a little house, which was his little hermitage near the monastery, working there. And he came out and he gave us an ice cream each, the workers, the people who were working there, he gave us an ice cream. I was so happy to receive the ice cream. And immediately sort of enthusiastic, yes, thank you, Father, you know, and I wanted to kiss his hand for it. And he pulled his hand away and looked at me. That glance of his to this day causes me much contrition. Because in one look he said to me very clearly, of all the things that I have given you, this is what you're happy for. It's embarrassing. It's a shame. It brings shame. I was happy about an ice cream. That's still me, by the way. I'm still working on that. Any more questions or comments? Yes.
This is kind of hard to put into words, so I'll do my best. I had a Catholic background, but I believe it's also Orthodoxy, that saints would detach themselves from attachments even to people, you know, and how does that compare to a personal God who wants relationship?
Okay, so saints detach themselves from all things, even people. And how does that compare? How does that relate to a God who wants to, could you say, who wants to have a personal relationship with us?
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you. That is a good question. The detachment of the saints, when we speak in that way, and I'll quote Father Zacharias on this. He speaks of how God wants us to be entirely His. God wants us to be, as we said, 100% with Him, and not to be divided in our person. The way that St. Paul speaks about the division in Him that he sees in Romans. That we're divided. We want God, but we also want the things of the world. We're attracted to God in some ways, but there's part of us that is very much still enamored of the pleasures that the world has to offer. So there's a division in us, and of course that division remains until the old man is truly dead, which involves many, many deaths, and also many, many resurrections. Thank God. So what they're referring to there is actually when we are detached from all created things and wholly and completely given over to God. I said that the Orthodox life, the Christian life, is one of paradox. The paradox here is the more we enter into the mystery of God, the more we share those things that we see in God. His characteristics, his love. His love which embraces all things. and all persons from the first man born of woman, from the first created man to the last man born of woman. So that's the parallel. We are invited to give ourselves entirely over to God, and in and through God, we enter into a deeper union with one another. And that is truly a great wonder. Abba Dorotheus talks about this, and that's where he gives that famous image of the wheel, you know, with the spokes coming from the outside of the wheel in towards the center. And he says that, you know, God is at the center, and the spokes, you notice the spokes in the wheel, get closer to each other as they approach the center of the wheel. So as we approach God, we also get closer to one another. And that is the mystery of God's love and care for each and every one of us, and how in and through Him we come to a deeper union with one another. And there is revealed to us the mystery of the two commandments, loving God with all your heart and with all your mind and with all your strength and so forth, and loving one's neighbor as oneself. It's really, again, it's one thing, one commandment. How are we doing, Father?
Very good. Thank you so much, Professor.
Thank you.
Well, we will now break for lunch, and we have lunch.